Good morning, everyone. My name is Poi Winnetrockle, and as the editor-in-chief of the NYU Law Review, I have the pleasure of welcoming you this morning to the Law Review Symposium on the Presidential Nominations Process. The Law Review's editorial board voted to adopt a set of values that would guide the choices we would make this academic year. We wanted to use our short time in the journal's leadership to seek innovative ideas that boldly address the challenges we face today. And we wanted our contribution to be not simply to publish scholarship that remains in the academy, but we wanted to elevate the ideas and arguments that impact the law and society. And we could not be more thrilled to be hosting a symposium on a topic that fully captures those values today. I'm so happy that we are going to be hosting this symposium today with wonderful speakers. Today's symposium on the presidential nominations process will bring together experts from different sides of the aisle, from a diversity of backgrounds and experiences. So you'll be hearing from former members of Congress, top-notch political scientists, and the greatest legal minds in the field of law and democracy. Speaking of which, we on the Law Review are so fortunate to have had the opportunity to work with two of those great legal minds, Professor Bauer and Professor Pildes, who's somewhere on the panel, right there, who are the faculty co-sponsors of the symposium, and I want to just take a minute to thank them both for putting forth their generous support, guidance, and enthusiasm for putting this all together. So today we'll take a historical look at how we have selected the leader of the executive branch. Our experts will then address recent issues, and in the afternoon we'll take a critical dive into what the future might or should hold. And I don't have to say this to this audience, basically how important the issue of selecting our president is, but today's events are also an opportunity for us to discuss how we want to be represented, how we want our democracy to operate, and how we want to structure ourselves as a society. I think these are some of the most pressing issues in the law, and I invite everyone here to think deeply and to engage critically with those questions and to engage with our panelists in exploring some of those possible answers today. Since I fully expect to resolve America's existential crisis by the end of the afternoon, I'll say no more and I'll turn it over to Professor Bauer. Thank you for coming today.
Thank you very much. It's time for me to return the compliment. Obviously, in any venture like this, the real work takes place behind the scenes and has been done by the Law Review, by POI, by the articles editor, Peter Devlin. The entire team has done a phenomenal job in putting this together, and we're obviously very grateful because it makes the speakers and the participants look much better than they should. And I want to thank POI for her kind remarks. Every introduction is characterized by overstatement. This much I will concede, Rick Pildes, at least, does possess a great legal mind. The rest of it,
first nice thing you've ever said about me.
Yes,
and
I remembered that it was recorded, I would not have said it. In any event, I do want to say that we are, as Poi said, hoping to have a creative and engaged conversation about this critical question about the selection of the most powerful political figure in the country, also frequently referred to sometimes. In context that could give rise to dispute, a leader of the free world. And this is a topic that has consumed our politics for some time, and it's not clear that we're really getting anywhere terribly productively. So we hope that we can be part of a conversation that will expand and will engage others across the country in political science and law in thinking about the systems that we use to select the president. You're going to hear a number of different perspectives, comparative, historical, political science, looking back, looking forward, focusing on recent events, all of which are intended to illuminate how we put together a system that, by any number of measures, is up to the task of selecting our president. That is to say, that arranges for an appropriate measure of popular will, that allows for the selection of capable candidates who, upon election, can govern the country, that provides for vetting, that provides over the course of the campaign the opportunity for an illuminating debate that really surfaces the issues for public deliberation, And our system has undergone a number of changes you'll hear over time. We've experimented with a lot of different ways of doing it, and there's no reason why we can't look hard, and rather than see the features as we have them today as fixed, look possibly to changes that will dramatically improve our ability to succeed on those particular measures. And so I look forward to an informed conversation by people that I happen to know are really the tops in their field. The papers that have been produced are excellent. The presentations, I'm confident, will match. And so I am very, very pleased now to open the first panel. I'm going to turn it over to my good friend and perpetual adversary, Ben Ginsberg, and ask him to introduce his panelists and the subject of the first panel. So thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Bob. It's a pleasure to be up here at NYU among my political base. Great to see you all. And thank you for holding this panel, which is on, obviously, a very important and crucial subject. We've moved over the past number of decades and really a couple centuries from a peer review system of old to smoke-filled rooms to now sort of an utter populist nominating system. 2016, the major parties succeeded in nominating the two least popular candidates in American presidential history. 2008 saw the nomination of a senator who had not yet filled out one term. That is historically different from who most of our nominees are, although from time to time, peanut farmers and movie actors slide in there as well. So the whole nominating process is has a rich and glorious history in the country that is certainly worth exploring. We're going to begin today with a look back at what has happened in history and with a look at how other countries nominate their candidates for some guidance on whether the reform notions of our contemporary nominating system really have some guideposts and some places to go that might be practical. Our speakers today are Fred Martin, from Bancroft Private Equity in Vienna, Austria, who has clearly figured out how to live life right. In the 1980s, he worked for Walter Mondale and has a great deal of experience in the presidential nominating and political electing process. Our second speaker is your very own Rick Pildes, the Sudler Family Professor of Constitutional Law. Fred has really a fascinating piece on the history of our nominating process and what went on in ancient times in some other jurisdictions. Rick will take a look at contemporary foreign systems of nominating, and I think this will be an informative look at guidelines that we might use to improve our system. So with that, Fred.
Thank you, Ben, and thank you to NYU and the Law Review in particular for organizing this conference. Today's topic, the presidential nominating system, can be a trifle dull, but if anyone could get us finally talking about it, it would be Donald Trump and his incongruous occupancy of the White House. So at least there's one thing we can be grateful for. My assignment today is talk about history. History of nominating systems is voluminous. I'm reminded of Churchill saying that the Balkans had more history than they knew what to do with, and that's the I'm beginning to feel that way about this paper. So I'll try to condense it and deliver it concise as I can. The history of the nominating system probably breaks down into two periods. One is the Democratic era, and the other is the pre-Democratic era, or otherwise the partisan nominating systems that have prevailed pretty much since the 19th century, and prior to that, what I would call sort of hermetic systems, which started in the Middle Ages and continued through to the 19th century. What are the hermetic principles? Under the hermetic systems, particularly in Europe, the political elites would select a subset of themselves in order to nominate and then choose a leader. And they would do so according to very elaborate procedures. And the point of those elaborate procedures was to wall the system off from influence and try to prevent an outcome where some rich person, important family, some geography in the polity would capture or seize the process and run away with the office and get a monopoly on the office. The procedures were, in summary, having a multi-stage complex process for trying to nominate someone, having the nominators be isolated for their decision making. You think of the papal conclave locked behind the doors of the Vatican, and the same was true in many in a host of other elections. Tight timetables so that nominators had to make a decision very quickly and could not therefore be influenced or lobbied by someone else or outside of the process. A frequent recurrence of absolute majorities as a requirement for candidates to proceed through the process, and in many cases, curiously, an insistence on super majorities for candidates to progress through the process, and even in some cases, well, in quite a few, to actually be chosen as the leader, as opposed to minority or plurality or absolute or simple majorities. Often, curiously, the use of sortition or lottery in the process comes up. One of the examples that's interesting to take a look at sometime is the election of the Doge in Venice, which was a republic that lasted about 8 centuries, and it has been said that it did last precisely because of this very complex, elaborate, multi-stage process by which the Doge was selected, which included sortition, election of nominators, a 10-stage process, which included approval voting in some of those stages, and which included in all those stages supermajorities being required for people to advance to the next stage, and ultimately the Doge, when he was chosen, required 25 votes out of the 41, a supermajority of over 60%. There were similar, not so exotic or lengthy procedures throughout northern Italy during the Middle Ages in the early modern period. Some of these crept into colonial America as well. Those features of creating a hermetic process, sealed off from influence, elaborate procedures, multi-stage, supermajorities, you see coming up again and again and again from about the 12th century through to the 19th. On the other side of the Great Divide is the democratic era, beginning in more or less the early 19th century. What we call the partisan control of nominating. In the US, we sort of transitioned into that partisan control over a period of decades. It didn't happen instantly. In Article 2 of the Constitution, as originally drafted, it was originally created as a sort of a hermetic process, the electoral system was. That is, the Electoral College was designed to have electors meet separately from each other in each of their states on the same day, and bear in mind that those states were sometimes 2 weeks, 3 weeks from each other by carriage or stagecoach, in order to vote on that same day, vote sealed up, sent to Washington, opened after secrecy was protected, opened on the same day, results, and if no one had a majority, if there were a tie, it goes to the House where the votes are by state. A process where the design, at least, the thought at least, was to seal the nomination off from influence, lobbying, cabal, and intrigue, as they called it, and so forth. Of course, it almost instantly failed to achieve its goal, because within a very short period of time, it became apparent that if you differed with other people in the country and you had a view you wanted to sort of hope to get expressed through the political process, you had to influence the choice of electors, and you had to coordinate how those electors were going to vote, which gave rise to partisan activity. I wouldn't say formal parties, but certainly a lot of organizing as early as the 1790s across states. Interestingly, those partisans found that this hermetic electoral college was a very tricky body to manipulate. It's very hard to determine the outcome. Why? Principally because of the rule of two votes per elector. If you recall, in the original Constitution, each elector cast two votes for president. No separate designation for president or for vice president. And that led to a very tricky situation for the Federalists and for the Republicans, because you could instruct your electors to vote uniformly for your top two guys. And if you did that, you had a couple risks or dangers. One is that you could tie, and your two top guys would be tied. And that's what happened in 1800, in which case, as you know, election went to the House, where the Federalists did their level best to try to elect Burr instead of Jefferson. Okay? The other resort is you could say, no, we're going to ask our electors to throw away the second vote, precisely so we can avoid any risk to myself as the number one guy. That's what Adams did in 1796. He got enough of them of his own party to throw away the second vote, that guess what? Thomas Jefferson became the vice president, who was his arch rival. Now, Adams didn't like that, but he liked it better than if Pinckney had become president, which was what he was trying to avoid, his own running mate actually beating him. Well, as you can see, the system had built into it a grave unpredictability. And right after the 1800 election, the Republicans decided we're going to change this, and they drafted the 12th Amendment to the Constitution, doing away with the double vote and designating, or calling on, providing for electors to designate whom they were going to cast their one vote for president, and one vote for the vice president. That enabled parties then to do what they'd already been trying to do, but enabled them to do a lot more effectively. In the, curiously, in the debate over that amendment, the Federalists pointed out that this was a fundamental change to the system, and that it was a change which was repealing what they described as the Great Compromise of the Electoral College. The Great Compromise being that the college, Electoral College, would be doing the nominating of candidates, when the big states would have their outsized role there, and the House, voting by states, after all, would do the electing. And they said, now you've changed the system, that's the end of the compromise. Uriah Tracy said in the Senate debate, we wouldn't have come into this union had we known that you were going to deprive the small states, or in some cases you could have read that to mean the minority party, of a significant role in the election, and indeed in the possible election in the House. And I think that they were right. That is, if you go back and check the minutes of the records of the convention in 1787, there are frequent references to this alleged compromise between big states and small states. Big states get to nominate in the Electoral College, small ones do the deciding in the House. You see this in the words of Madison, Morris, Pinckney, and a couple others. That system then gave rise to the so-called party era, which I think you probably know about, and that was where parties, by at least the 1830s or so, managed to capture the nominating process. It was composed of three or four features. One, multi-stage process, very much like old-fashioned multi-stage. That is, there wasn't just one event, but there were a series of elections of delegates at congressional level and at state level and at the national level. Two, unpledged delegates, and therefore that put an immense amount of power in the hands of bosses to be able to arbitrate and move votes around. So that then led to a sort of third feature, which was the nominating process played an integrative role. It was a process by which a nominee, or a candidate rather, could only have any hope of success if he, and they were all he's, if he made an effort to appease different power blocks in the country. It was an integrative sort of function that the parties played, and the nominees were very well aware of that, the candidates were, I mean. And this was especially true in the Democratic Party, which had the two-thirds rule. As you know, for 104 years, Democrats said, in order to be the nominee, you need to get two-thirds of the delegates, 1832 to 1936. That had a huge effect on how candidates behaved, and lastly, partly because of that rule, but also the general integrativeness, conventions actually decided things in the 19th century. This system prevailed until it was attacked by progressive reformers for the bossism and the corruption, beginning the attack really, I suppose, 1880s, 1890s. There was a conference here in New York in 1898 where reformers got together and said, we've got to do something about this horribly corrupt system. And what emerged from that was a call for direct primaries. It took a couple years, but beginning in 1905-ish, States started to pass direct primary laws with a large number of them during the year for 1912. That was really sort of the beginning of the direct primary heyday, where Theodore Roosevelt competed and beat Taft and his hand-chosen successor in a bunch of primaries, and actually won more primary votes than did Taft. But nonetheless, because of the role of unpledged delegates and bosses, Taft was able to control a majority of the convention. We ended up with this sort of mixed system then. In most of the 20th century, what is called the mixed system or hybrid system, which is a combination of primaries and bosses. It's a little more complicated than just smoke-filled rooms, because a candidate to succeed had to really do two things. He, or increasingly she, had to gather support from sufficient number of power blocks as represented by state bosses in order to get the nomination. But at the same time, that person had to prove that he or she was competitive electorally in a few select primaries. And if you just pleased the bosses but just lost a lot of primaries, it was going to be difficult for you. If, on the contrary, you just won a lot of primaries but didn't please the bosses, you weren't going to get nominated either. And we had at least 10 or 12 times during the 20th century when the person who won the most primary votes did not get nominated in the end. One of the most egregious, or I should say, one of the biggest travesties, of course, was in 1968, when Humphrey, having won 2% of the vote, was nominated over McCarthy, who got 38% of the primary vote. And it was after that that we then did the reforms of 1972, producing the system that more or less we have today, and that we've been living with for 50 years. It has, the system today has the virtues of being simple, and has the virtue of being transparent, and has the virtue of massive voter participation. It does, however, have a series of unforeseen consequences, and I'll just focus on a couple of them, bearing in mind how they differ, how these consequences are different from some of the historical precedents I've just ticked off. One, as I said, it's a very simple process. It's essentially one stage. Yes, there are multiple contests, but there's one thing happening: going to voters and asking them, and then if you get a plurality win, you're looking pretty good and you move on to the next state. It's a very simple one stage process versus historically, as I've tried to indicate, there's been a lot of complexity in our systems in the past for the reasons that I said. Number two, it's a very candidate-centric system, as we know, since the parties are not really playing very much of a role any longer. And the candidate centricity is almost the opposite of what the Hermetic system was trying to do. It was trying to control and protect the nominating system from candidates. This one is all about the candidates. And if I can just pause on that for a second, or a digression for a second, modern campaigns for the nomination are so unpleasant and so degrading that, in my view, it takes almost a personality disorder to submit oneself to it. Rather than having a sort of selection process, we have a kind of adverse selection process in which the people who volunteer for this assignment are probably the last ones, in some instances, that you would want to see get near the Oval Office. And the flip side of that is true as well. A lot of very good people, a lot of very capable, mature people that we would like to see run won't get near this. They don't want to go through this process. So that's another feature that I think we need to sort of try to deal with. The third point, candidates are called out, drop out very early in the process now. And that's because of the sequencing and because they don't get the plurality wins, and so they drop out. Sometimes half a dozen dropped out before voting even started in this last election. That's the opposite of what used to happen, which is that we kept candidates in until the very end. There was no reason previously in the 19th century to drop out because no one had a lock on the nomination then. And then lastly, the early culling, the early dropping out, is very much made worse by the plurality wins, which define a victory. You can be the winner with 25%, 26%, 30%. I think Trump got 25 and 35% in Iowa and in New Hampshire. That's quite typical, quite common. That's a big win. The trouble is, then people who don't get those 25% wins, so-called wins, drop out. And because of the oddity of plurality voting, we don't know if the people dropping out are actually possibly more preferred than those who are staying in. And if the people who are staying in and being sort of propelled along toward the nomination might just in fact be more broadly disliked than some of those who drop out early. So there's a diabolical mixture here of sequencing of contests. There's no other country, I think, that does this. Sequencing combined with plurality wins, which makes for very random results that I think are a threat to us. Versus in the past. In the past, whether it's the Hermetic system or in the 19th century America, supermajorities were by and large the rule. So we're doing the opposite of supermajorities today. So in summary, I think we're missing today versus the past some complexity. I think we're much more at the mercy of the candidates today than we used to be, and some of them are very deeply flawed people, I think. We're missing the continued competition of capable qualified candidates, or even the entrance of some capable and qualified candidates, which is a shame. And then lastly, we are missing the voting mechanisms that our forebears spent a lot of time on trying to think through. They spent a lot of time on the complexities and on the details of voting mechanisms to arrive at either approval voting, preferential voting, two-thirds or supermajority results in order to end up with a candidate. I think these problems are fixable. I think there are some remedies. We can talk about them later. But they are fundamental problems. The challenge I think we face is not about when does Iowa appear in the calendar, or New Hampshire, or a few more superdelegates, a few fewer. It's really a fundamental problem that's not going to be fixed by fiddling with those rather smaller issues. And I think we need a new system. We've had dysfunctional systems in the past, and we've changed them in 1804. Also in 1912, also in 1972, we've changed them, and I think that it's time to change once again. Thank you.
So I want to start off by thanking both Bob, who is really the principal architect of this event, and the Law Review for being willing to host this symposium. This is going to be, when it's in print, I believe the most sustained and systematic set of challenges that is out there in literature to the current way we choose presidential nominees. So I think this is going to turn out to be a highly significant intellectual, academic contribution, and also a political contribution. I want to thank Fred also, because I had never before felt qualified to consider running for president. But now that I've learned that the major qualification is a personality disorder, I am hereby announcing my candidacy for the Fred Martin Party. So those of us who believe significant changes to the presidential nomination process are needed in the United States, particularly those of us who would like to see a reinsertion of some meaningful role for what's been called peer review, or the role of party figures, national and state party figures in the selection process, recognize that this is a long-term kind of ideological and cultural struggle, which has to be engaged in before many of the more specific reform proposals that Fred and a number of the other papers have put forward and are going to put forward. And let me just say at the outset a little bit about what I see as the nature of that struggle and the way in which the paper that I've co-written with Professor Stephen Garbaum here contributes to that struggle. So institutionally, as has been mentioned, we're talking about the choice between more populist-oriented selection methods, which is what our current system involves, and systems that mediate popular participation in various ways, including potentially, as I say, building in or rebuilding in a role for party figures in the selection process. We currently have the most populist selection system in the world for choosing presidential nominees or the comparable figures, party leaders, nominees for chief executive in other democracies. So part of the struggle, as I see it, is that we have had this current system of presidential primaries with caucuses as well, but a fundamentally populist system of presidential control in which the voting process itself completely controls the outcome and the choice of who the party nominees are for nearly 50 years now, since the changes of the 1970s. And as a result, it becomes natural or taken for granted by most of us that this is how we do it, that this is what democracy means. How else could it be done? What else would a democratic system do in the way of choosing candidates for the president? And that's one of the things any reform effort has to inevitably fight against. The second thing is, ever since the 1960s, the central thrust of most political reform efforts has been to press for greater and greater and more direct forms of popular participation in the political process. Popular participation is often looked to as a kind of magic solvent for all of our democratic ills, and any effort, any pressure, any momentum to try to change the nomination process, particularly to insert some role for party figures in the form of peer review, or even to maintain the small vestiges of peer review that remain, like the superdelegates in the Democratic Party, inevitably confronts this dominant political culture that kind of sacralizes now popular participation in a way that makes it very difficult to defend or push for reform proposals that press back against that ideology. So this paper is designed to engage that larger ideological struggle and to provide a sort of a broader framework for the specific reform proposals by trying to destabilize or undermine the taken for granted notion that the primary process we have now is the natural or best or only democratic way to select presidential nominees. And we seek to do that through two different methods. One, which is part of what Fred is doing as well, is to put our current system in American historical context. And the history reminds us that for over 200 years of American politics, we chose nominees through a process that had a significant role, indeed a dominant role, for what we call peer review, or the judgments of party figures, national and state, in the process of selecting presidential nominees. As Fred said, starting in 1912, there was an insertion of some role for primaries in the process, not, by the way, because there was a great populist upswelling, or there was some, for popular participation, but because Teddy Roosevelt knew the only way he could possibly get the nomination was to try to bypass the party hierarchy that was now controlled by President Taft. It was political self-interest that led to the injection or insertion initially of some role for primaries in 1912. But the history shows us, or helps remind us, of how radical the transformation was that was made virtually overnight in the 1970s. We went from a system that for over 200 years had some role for peer review in the selection process to one in which within 8 years, from 1968 to 1976, had basically eliminated the party figures from having any meaningful role in the nomination process. And it turned over that process completely to popular control through the primary elections and the caucuses, which controlled the vast majority of the delegates to the conventions. So a little bit of historical perspective, I think, provides some sense of the contingency of that historical moment and how much the change, what we live with now, was actually a product of dramatic change at a particular moment in time. The second thing we do in the paper to try to undermine this sense that this is the only way democracies choose their leading candidates for chief executive is to look at how major democracies around the world choose the equivalent candidates. You don't have to look just to 15th century Italy and the Doges, though that was pretty interesting to read about. But if you look at major democracies today, you get further perspective on how much of an outlier the U.S. method that we've had since the 70s is compared to many other stable and well-established democracies. Now, one further point about the issues we're talking about is that these issues engage also the larger questions that are roiling democratic politics in many democracies today with respect to the rise of populism and populist forms of politics. And this specific choice in the design of democratic processes, the choice, the method by which nominees for chief executive or for party leader are chosen, in my view, has enormous effects on exactly this question of whether populist political forces, which rise from time to time in response to economic struggles, cultural struggles, and the like, whether these forces are able to capture control in a fairly immediate and direct way of government, or whether there are mediating devices that make it more difficult for those kinds of forces when they arise to immediately gain control of government. And it's really remarkable to me, actually, how little academic attention has been devoted to this question, particularly since the 1970s, of selection methods that different countries use. Okay, on the historical side, since Fred covered a certain amount of that, I'm not going to say too much, except I want to emphasize one point. This radical change that we made to this populist selection system in the 1970s, in the aftermath of the 68 Democratic Convention, was itself almost an inadvertent, accidental change that we stumbled into as much as something that had been kind of rationally deliberated about and thought through, and this new system that emerged being one that was the product of careful reflection and decision making, that this is a much better way we ought to select presidential nominees. In fact, if you look back at the reformers who were the catalyst for these changes, the McGovern-Fraser Commission, which was there to basically respond to the anti-war Democratic left that had been so outraged by the 1968 Democratic Convention, said that they were not actually trying to accomplish what they inadvertently brought about, which is the system of direct primaries controlling the process. So here's Austin Rainey, who was one of the members of the commission. We did not seek a great increase in the number of state primaries. Indeed, we hoped to prevent any such development by reforming the delegate selection rules so that the party's non-primary processes, like caucuses, would be open and fair, participation in them would greatly increase, and consequently, the demand for more primaries would fade away. But we got a rude shock. We accomplished the opposite of what we intended. And then if you look at the discussion within the Democratic Party about how they understood these changes and what they were doing, the leading kind of studies of this basically say they didn't understand the practical effects of adopting these proposals. And no one wanted to rock the boat in 1972 by challenging these proposals. The fear, as is true today, of the left wing of the Democratic Party, the anti-war left back then, responding dramatically to any failure to adopt these proposals so dominated the discussion that they simply adopted these reform proposals that the reformers themselves did not realize and did not intend would have the effect of producing this primary-dominated process in which the party figures were completely removed for all practical purposes from the selection process. So I mentioned that on the historical side, which we discuss in part again, to undermine a little bit the notion that what we have is the product of deep and careful thought rather than something that is often true in politics that we kind of stumbled into somewhat accidentally and have been living with ever since. Now, when you look in comparative perspective, which is what I want to turn to now, we categorize the way different countries, the ones we survey, choose nominees for party leader or the equivalent kinds of positions into four categories. I'll give you some examples of each. I'll try to be brief about this, but to just give you some context. There are systems that are ones involving what we call purely peer review, which is purely a peer review system with no direct popular participation. There are mixed systems like the one we had until the 1970s that mix elements of peer review with some role for popular participation. There are systems that we call neither pure peer review nor populist systems, and then there are the mostly populist systems that resemble the one we have, though not nearly as extreme as what we have. So purely peer review systems, which are in some ways the most interesting because they're the biggest contrast to what we have. You see this in Germany, in Australia, in New Zealand, South Africa, in India. In Australia, for example, for the two parties, the center-right parties in Australia and New Zealand, the way they make this choice is the parliamentary members from each party choose their party leader, period. It's like the old system from the 19th century in the United States, not even the early 20th century. And for the center-left parties in both countries, that's how they operated as well until 2013. Then they made some changes to the system. And the regulation of the process is wholly internal to the party. Leadership contests take place every couple of years. And then the party leaders and the parties stand for election, you know, in the general election. But the filtering process is through the people who are elected from the party to the parliament. Germany, good old now, in modern Germany, stable, good government, you know, sober Germany, you know, how do they do this? By law, the party leaders are chosen by delegates to a national conference of party delegates every 2 years, but the party elites basically get together in advance and coordinate and work out a consensus. And these conferences of these relatively small numbers of party delegates are more coronations than they are actually selection processes. So basically, Germany works as a pure peer review system as well. I won't go into the details about places like India, but that gives you a taste for what are these pure peer review systems. They exist. I don't know if any of us think of Australia or Germany as not a democratic country. These systems are viewed as consistent, indeed desirable ways of structuring the process in a democracy. There are systems that, as I say, mix elite control with degrees of popular participation. The UK, Ireland, Japan are examples of this. In the UK, I'll talk a bit about that because it's obviously so relevant and interesting. The Conservative Party, well, first of all, let me say, you have to be a member of the party in the House to even be considered to run for party leader. So that would have taken both Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump out of consideration in this cycle in the US. But then in addition, the Conservative Party winnows down the potential party leaders to two candidates through balloting of the members of the party in parliament, and then the two candidates are submitted to the party membership for a choice. But party membership is a much thicker concept in many of these countries than in the US. So what it means to be a member of the political party, the Conservative Party, is you pay dues. There are only about 150,000 formal members. So these two candidates are submitted to the party electorate, which is this much narrowed electorate, for the choice. When Theresa May became party leader recently after Cameron had to resign because of Brexit, if you followed that story, the Conservatives were faced with the idea of Boris Johnson as a possible nominee. He decided not to run. Why? Because a populist figure like that understood he was not going to be one of the two figures that the members in Parliament from the Conservative Party would endorse. So this process filtered out a candidate like Boris Johnson from being Conservative Party leader.
They nominated two people. The second woman decided to withdraw, and Theresa May became leader of the party without any popular vote, actually, even of the party electorate. In the Labour Party, you have to get 15% support from members of the party in Parliament before you can run as party leader, and then if you qualify, that also goes to the party electorate at that point. I'll just mention, I find this fascinating. So an example in Ireland for alternative ideas, they use a weighted voting system, which mixes peer review and popular participation. Members of the party in Parliament, it's like an electoral college, their votes count for 65% towards the party nominee. Party members, their votes count 25% to the nomination. And then what are called local councillors, which are connected to the party, 10% towards the nomination. So weighted voting schemes like this mix popular participation and a significant role for peer review. There are some systems that are mostly populist like ours. The first pure primary election in Europe, comparable to ours, didn't happen until 2005 in Italy. So that's how late purely populist systems came to Europe. Italy is one of the countries that uses that system. Again, that stable, well-functioning democracy. Argentina, another model democracy, uses the purely populist systems of selection. France does as well, so that's maybe a better case for these systems. So that gives you just a, you know, in quick summary, a feel for the range of different ways of doing this that other democracies use in contrast to our system. Now, even the countries that have popular participation, it's important to understand what that means and how different it is from popular participation in the United States. So there are many other factors about how democracy is organized in our system and these other systems that contribute to the question of how much party figures play a role in selecting nominees beyond this particular feature of the actual selection process. So for example, in most democracies, campaign funding, whether it's public or private, is channeled through the political party organizations, not through individual candidates, as it is here. In most places, as I mentioned, party membership requires a thicker form of participation than just checking off a registration card, as it does here. Usually it requires paying dues. And that means party membership is a much narrower segment of the full electorate or all of the people who will vote for the party candidate in the general election. So even systems that submit and have a role for the party electorate, as I mentioned, it's not what you might imagine in the United States. We had 60 million people voting in the primaries. And these other countries like Canada that uses popular participation, Israel, the UK, the number of people in the party electorate might be 150,000 out of millions who will end up voting in the general election. And in many countries, there's a well-understood and necessary track you have to travel in terms of qualifications and experience to be considered plausible as a party leader. So someone like Macron in France, even as a supposed outsider, is a completely inside, experienced former government minister, trained at the fanciest French institutions for governance. He's not an insurgent outsider in the way you might think of him from the US. A closing word about populism and how these selection methods may affect populism. In many of the European, many of the other democracies, as we said, as you know, there is a, you know, this tremendous roiling in their democratic politics, and there are populist political forces that are coming to the surface and are politically significant. In most of these countries, though, because of what I've just described, it's much harder for these figures to capture control of one of the major parties that is likely to actually govern. Instead, if you look at what's happening, not everywhere, but in many places, what you see is the rise of other parties, smaller parties, that are the carriers of this populist set of forces, the National Front in France, the Five Star Party in Italy, UKIP, Alternative for Germany, Wilders Party in the Netherlands. These are not the major parties being captured by populist political forces, partly because these selection methods make it so much harder for that to happen. So they exist, they get political expression, but they're channeled into these other party forms, which I think is a healthier way for these forces to find political expression. So the purpose of this paper isn't to offer specific reform proposals. Many of the papers do that, but it's to try to clear the ideological space, if you will, or the cultural space, to make it possible to have more serious discussions about particular reforms, whether they're appropriate, whether they're consistent with democracy. One of the things I take issue with in Fred's commentary is I think he uses the word democracy in a very kind of loose way. And I think there are many ways of institutionalizing democracy. I think all of these countries are democratic systems. They have hermetically sealed processes, if, to use your language, or greater role for peer review than we do. But I don't think that makes them not democratic systems. I mean, that's what we're debating. What is the best way to understand and to institutionalize democracy, particularly with respect to this absolutely critical dimension, as we have become more aware of in recent years, of the methods by which the candidates, the leading candidates for the major parties are chosen. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick and Fred. What we would like to do for the next 35 minutes or so is have some questioning and discussion. Now, the truth is, we had so much fun in our sort of planning call that we all have questions for each other. So we're going to start out with those and exercise moderator's prerogative and then turn it over. So look, while notions of peer review dance in our heads, the reality in the United States is that the setting of the rules of the nominating system is in the hands of 168 members of the Republican National Committee and 400 and something members of the Democratic National Committee. Very few of the members of either committee are, in fact, elected officials. Some of the more granular rules about whether there's a state primary or a state convention is determined by each of the 50 states. In terms of trying to improve the U.S. system that we all acknowledge needs some improving, what examples from Rick, other nations, or Fred from the historical past would you give to the distinguished members of the Republican and Democratic National Committees to actually change the system?
You go first.
Thank you. I guess the first question we'd have to ask ourselves, and it's the one that you touch on, Rick, is are we going to go back to a non-plebiscitary system or not? Are we going to stick with multiple plebiscites or not? And that's kind of a big fork in the road. Because if you think it's feasible or possible to reverse or to dial down on the plebiscites, as we did after 1916, then there's all kinds of choices. If on the other hand you come to the view that the plebiscites, the 60 million people that are currently voting, are going to want to continue voting, or the parties will want to continue having them vote, then what you're trying to do, I think, is look at, well, how can we make amendments to the voting procedures itself in order to render the outcomes a little less random. So as an example from the past, as I mentioned earlier, there's lots of evidence or lots of examples of approval voting or preferential voting, super majorities that are required, which you could consider trying to insert into the primary system rather than relying on the first past the post plurality wins. The second problem or issue would be sequencing, if we're going to continue with these plebiscites. This sequencing is diabolical in the sense of the culling that happens, and as I described earlier, it has a bunch of negative features. I think there are a couple of things that could be done about that. One is you could try but this has lots of problems with it, having votes on one day instead of spread through 5 months or 4 months. Or secondly, you could sort of adopt, as you said, Rick, the Tory practice from the UK, which is in their case having the party members select two candidates that are then put to vote. You could imagine that you flip timing around and have a convention that comes before the primaries instead of after the primaries, and that the purpose of the convention is to come up with two candidates only. Now, if you have two candidates only, then the sequencing, the multiple contests, become a lot less manageable as problems, and there's no plurality win issue. Whenever we get down to sort of Obama and Clinton, or Clinton and Sanders, let's say, and you've got two, the sequencing is something you can deal with. It's not so dangerous. That would help with the so-called vetting problem. The last thing I'd say is, what I don't think I would recommend is to solve the vetting candidate centricity problem by imposing a party veto after the voting has happened. I think that's what we did for a good deal of the 20th century. I think when you ask 30 million people to vote in your party, and then you don't like the result and you say, just kidding, here's the person that we're going to nominate, I think you've built in a good dose of hypocrisy into the center of your system. So if you're going to have vetting, I think the vetting should be more in terms of filtering rather than vetoing after the fact.
That's very good.
So one of the things I like about the way Fred is thinking about this is that he's accepting as a constraint the plebiscitary kind of process on the view that that's kind of irreversible as a matter of political culture, and looking for ways of tinkering with voting rules. You didn't mention here establishing a two-thirds requirement in the convention, which is another, or reestablishing a two-thirds requirement in the convention, which is another way of trying to do that. And I thought that was a very interesting direction for thought, very creative direction for thought. Most of us have thought more about, you know, are there ways of reinstituting some role for peer review? Of course, the Democratic Party reached the conclusion after it turned out that this system produced the disasters of George McGovern in 72 and then Jimmy Carter in 76. What have we wrought? And in the post-1980 period, the Democratic Party did reform its rules to try to build back in this role for the elected party figures who have come to be called the superdelegates, who now are something like 18 or 19% of the delegates at the convention. We don't know whether those figures would ever, in our current political culture, have the political capacity, if you will, in a relatively kind of close context, to actually be the decisive players in making the choice. So that's an open question. One thing I would say is, I'm opposed to giving up the pieces that we still have of that mixed system. So right now, the DNC is talking about whether to make changes to the number of superdelegates, to reduce them. This is led by people like Liz Warren and Bernie Sanders. If you just watch the election we had and realize what can happen in the system, the kinds of candidates that can prevail in either political party under this system, I think having a kind of filter or veto, if you will, from a significant cadre of party figures is a desirable thing to maintain in the system. It may rarely be used. It may be very hard to have it used. Now, of course, in the Democratic Party, you see, if you talk to DNC people, a similar kind of appeasement process that sounds like it's taking place right now in the struggle over whether to maintain those superdelegates. Out of concern that the forces that want to get rid of them altogether won't turn out and mobilize in the 2018 elections, people on the DNC, some at least, say
even though they think it's a terrible idea to reduce the number of superdelegates, they're going to vote to support to do that in the hopes that that will cause the Sanders forces in the party to mobilize and be very, you know, active in 2018. You know, whether that's a bargain with the devil or not, whether it's the same thing that happened in 72 that caused the current system, you know, we'll have to see. I mean, one of the things I'm very curious about, I don't know if Ben can answer this question, but he's the subject of questions here too. He agreed, I think.
Maybe not.
And this may not be an appropriate question for you, but, you know, if it turns out that the Trump presidency implodes, we obviously don't know what's going to happen, and the Republicans lose in 2020 and lose badly, is that likely to cause the RNC, the leadership in the Republican Party, you know, as happened with Jimmy Carter and the Democrats, you know, would that be likely to be a significant catalyst for the Republican Party to consider whether they ought to build in some buffer role for the equivalent of superdelegates? Or is that not imaginable in the Republican Party, even under, you know, a kind of disastrous scenario that, that I'm imagining?
It's not imaginable under the current Republican Party. There's a real dislike of the notion of superdelegates for all sorts of historical reasons. I also think that the national committees are sort of unique institutions these days. There are, at least on the Republican side, not many elected officials, not many people who are ground in the politics of day-to-day campaigns, and they've become, over the last decade, much more debating societies. Go to an RNC meeting, they're talking about passing resolutions to help Mitch McConnell deal with the debt situation. They're not talking nearly as much about the nuts and bolts of campaigns, nor do they have people who are experienced in it. So it would be the debating society who actually were elected national committee members in 2020 before the general election took place, who then had to deal with, in your wild hypothetical, the mopping up of the process. Fred, you have a question you want to ask hopefully to Rick?
Yes. I thought there's a lot of stuff in your paper I thought was really, really helpful and interesting. I'm curious about, do you think that the major impetus for reform is to sort of wall off so-called populists and the populist surge that we've seen, or do you see other sort of institutional or party goals that we're trying to accomplish by changing the systems?
I would say other goals shortly, or there's a range of goals. So under the current system, inexperience in government seems to be a positive feature for candidates rather than a negative feature. I think that you know, some of the candidates who have been nominated and who have been elected under the post-70s system would have been nominated under the mixed system. So, you know, you have to be a little careful about how you sort this through. But I would say, you know, we've had a number of more inexperienced candidates since we made this change than we did before the 70s. I think that has had real costs to the effectiveness of our governance. So I'm worried about that. I thought your description of how when you have to work at least partly through the party figures nationally and state, you're forced to put together various kinds of coalitions to be able to get enough support to get over the threshold, I think that's a very desirable thing. I think that's one of the most important things political parties in general do in democracies when they work well, is they bring together a diverse array of interests, broad coalitions. Inevitably, there are compromises and trade-offs that have to be made. And finding figures who can most effectively do that within the party, I think, is quite a desirable feature of a selection system. I also worry, as one of the things I disagreed with that you said, is that some of these consequences of the change, the radical change in the 70s, were unforeseen. They were foreseen. by astute political scientists and political observers. And some of what people said at the time is, by the way, this was even going back to James Bryce in the late 19th century, who came over from England to study the American system. And when we started talking about using primaries for a limited role in the presidential process, he said, if this becomes national, it will eliminate all aspirants except those who possess conspicuous popular gifts. But put in the 1970s terminology or whatever, this famous line from Polsby and Ludovsky, who said, this change might lead to the appearance of extremist candidates and demagogues who don't have any significant ties to the political parties in any meaningful way, and stand really as independent personalities, appealing kind of in those terms. So, I mean, I think there are a variety of features that the extreme participatory or plebiscitory system that we've had since the 70s tends to select for in terms of the kinds of candidates who choose to run and the kinds of candidates who end up being successful. I actually believe, by the way, so this is a comment to Bill Mayer, who's got a paper I disagree with that I mentioned to Bill that will be presented later. I mean, I disagree with a piece of it, but I think that if we were in the mixed system from before the 1970s, a candidate like Donald Trump would not even have chosen to run as a figure in one of the major political parties. Not a question of whether he would have gotten the nomination, because there are selection effects from these rules of who chooses to run. People calculate how likely they are to succeed. In a system in which you had to get significant support from the party figures in addition to winning primaries, I'm not at all sure that he would have calculated he had a good enough chance to do that to even bother running. So, I mean, one way of putting this is I think the change that we made in the 70s makes possible nominees and candidates like a Donald Trump in a way that simply wouldn't have been possible before the 1970s.
Questions from all of you? John?
So my question is for Rick. First, just I'm broadly on your side of institutions being to be more important, part of the more important. But two things. One, I like your taxonomy of the world's selection systems, but isn't the juice running against your preferred method? That the European parties and Australian and British Labour parties have moved in that direction. They seem to be wireless, but there's some just moving in that direction. The second, I guess, is made an interesting point about European more closed parties pushing more populist sentiment and more populist characters to other outside parties. And you thought that was a healthy thing. Let me reverse that and see what you think. Arguably, Donald Trump might be seen as the leader of a party that's a coalition between a center-right European party and a populist party. And you brought those sentiments in. There were those views out there in the electorate. There are a significant number of people who believe those things. Is that a sort of taming of the populism by bringing it into the larger two-party system rather than walling off and saying either you're never going to be in government or creating figures maybe who are more extreme by doing it?
So on the first point, it's true that there has been, to the extent there's a trend or a tendency in the European and some of these other democracies, there is movement towards more forms of inclusion and more forms of participation. But in many of these places, that movement is to build in to the previously purely elite-controlled or party-controlled process some element of popular participation. That's why you're getting some of these mixed systems that I talked about. So, in places like Ireland, for example, where it was purely the members of the party who chose the nominees, now there's this electoral college-like process where there's weighted voting and there's some role for popular participation. But it's not a move towards anything like the US system in most places. I also think that the election of Donald Trump is going, I wonder if it's going to put a pause to that movement in some of these other democracies. And how they're going to absorb it, how they're going to understand it. whether they're going to be as enthusiastic about copying the U.S. system in this way. I have questions about. Now, I do think this is maybe a larger story. I don't want to give too long an answer to this. I do think that in the peer review system, the mixed system that we had, the populist anger and alienation and all of that that's genuine and is out there would be expressed. And there would be candidates who would carry that for those political forces. They would just be, the party figures would sort of mediate among the candidates who were carrying those political forces and presumably choose somebody who had experience in government, who they thought would appeal to a broad enough coalition, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's not like those forces would disappear. They would be channeled in different ways. I think when you have powerful political forces like that, they're going to find expression. But how they get expressed is very much affected by the institutional structures and the institutional design.
Yes.
The negative campaigning has been a feature of our campaigns and political life forever, and I don't see that changing. That is, I don't see what's going to be any sort of a mechanism or rule change that's going to prohibit candidates from saying what they want to say about the opposition. So I think that's just part of life, and I doubt that's going to be very different. On the voter participation, I don't know, you probably do, Rick, the voter participation numbers in general elections from 1960 to now. Certainly in the primaries, it's just gone way up. I mean, in the last 30 years, I think, as you pointed out, 30 million-ish are voting each year in each party, and it would have been a handful of people in the mixed system. So voter participation in our nominating systems is robust. I think the question is, I think it was said by Nelson Polsby, we're voting more and more, but with less and less meaning. And I think that's a good point, which is that we have a lot of voter participation, mass participation. The question is, what are we accomplishing with all of those votes? And I think that's exactly where some of the reforms we've been talking about today might be useful.
Can we take more questions?
Or? Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. I'm sorry.
Go ahead. You're next.
I'm intrigued by Fred Markman, by your suggestion of some kind of pre-clearance peer review system, which I haven't really heard discussed too much. I don't know how politically that's feasible. But related to that, is it possible for parties to impose requirements, stricter requirements, on who can be a candidate for primary? That might use some filter. And I had two thoughts in particular. Yep. One is, possible for a party to limit, potential candidates and people that are actually members of that party or registered with that party? And should a party require at least the disclosure of a minimum tax return before they can participate?
I'm going to bounce that to you because they're really more legal questions. I'm not sure I'm capable of answering them.
So
a good point.
Yeah, so it's certainly the case that the national political parties, the conventions, the RNC and the DNC, have the power
to say that if you're going to run on a state primary ballot, you have to be a party member. I don't think there's no question legally that they have the power to do that. They haven't been willing to assert that power, although I think that's a subject of some discussion now within the DNC after the 2016 election. They have the power to decide whether the primary election shall be closed primaries so that only party members can vote, or if there'll be open or semi-open primaries in which non-party members can vote. So the power to do all of that is there as a legal matter. In fact, there's a wonderful case when David Duke wanted to run on the Republican presidential primary ballot in Georgia. And Georgia had a law that allowed three members of the executive committee of the party to say somebody is not a legitimate Republican or a legitimate Democrat and keep them off the ballot. They kept David Duke off the ballot. He challenged it on constitutional grounds, and the court said, no, that's a perfectly fine statute. Party executive figures can be given the power to determine that somebody cannot run as a Republican or a Democrat because they are not consistent enough with the party's general philosophy. But certainly requiring that they be a party member is something that the parties have the full power to do.
I think as a practical matter, the mindset of the parties would be not to do that because they live in mortal fear of a viable third party option. And by saying we're not going to allow our 30 million primary voters to consider this individual, you're really creating an invitation to a third party. I think they're reluctant to do it. Yes?
Thank you. I'm just wondering if, following up on that question about voter participation, if anybody in the panel could speak to the kind of international comparison of three factors that actually many of us think seriously depresses the massive voter suppression that's been happening since Shelby versus Holder, and gerrymandering. Are those kind of uniquely American phenomenon that are playing into this larger picture that you're talking about? What's happening in other countries? And how do you think that plays into what you're suggesting for forming the nomination process?
Well, let me just say the comparisons with other countries about turnout rates are, you have to bear in mind there's a difference between proportional representation systems of election and first-past-the-post systems. So in PR systems, if you're supporting a minor party, like a Green Party, that's going to get 15% of the vote, it's still perfectly worth your time to vote because they'll get 15% of the representation. In first-past-the-post systems, those kinds of parties don't exist because they're not going to get any political power because you have to get 50% of the vote plus one or be a plurality winner that comes close to that. And that, I think, has significant, that in and of itself, I think, is going to affect turnout rates to a significant extent because people who would be inclined to vote for parties they feel ideologically comfortable with can do it in these PR systems in a way that your vote is not effective to do in the US. It is true that most other countries do automatically register their voters. I'm in favor of that. I think that is one of the more important political reforms that could take place. I think there is significant movement on that front these days. Gerrymandering doesn't affect Senate elections or presidential elections. And it may affect turnout in elections for the House and the like if the elections aren't competitive. But in terms of national turnout in presidential elections, I'm skeptical that that's a significant contributor. You look like you want to say something about that.
Today in the Senate and in the
Well, this is opening up a whole different set of questions. I don't know how far to get into them. Let me just say that it's common in the media to blame all sorts of problems in American democracy on gerrymandering. I think gerrymandering is a terrible thing. I think the power should not be in the hands of self-interested legislators, but the empirical literature doesn't actually support a lot of the things that are commonly said about the effects of gerrymandering, in part because the popular commentary does a very bad job of distinguishing between concentration of voters by party due to geographic kinds of clustering of voters by party versus willful and intentional manipulation of district lines that creates safer districts for members of one party or the other. So there's much less empirical support for the view that gerrymandering is a significant contributor to political polarization, for example, than the assertion you made. I'm in favor, you know, I want the Supreme Court to act in this case, and I'm in favor of shifting the power to independent commissions and things that both Bob and Ben, you know, would oppose me on. But I think you have to be careful about buying into the view that gerrymandering is a fundamental source of most of the ills in American democracy today.
Tana.
You mean by the demographic shift, the massive immigration of the 19th century?
Demographic shift in terms of racial minority participation, demographic shifts from urban to rural, or rural to urban areas. I mean, we had a significant move in demographics that I think underpinned some of the rules that the parties have chosen in their nominating.
Yeah. The 19th century system was surprisingly filled with mass participation, excluding African Americans. That is, there was, when I got into this, I was surprised to see how many people were involved in voting at local levels and at county levels, congressional district levels, and state levels in order to select delegates to go up through the process. That excluded, obviously, a large part of the population that was female and that was African American. That didn't change until we got into the 20th century. Now, I guess your question is, how did that shift change the rules? I don't think the abandonment of the boss convention system at the beginning of the 20th century, the so-called introduction of the mixed system of primaries and of bosses, I don't think that that was a direct response to demographic shifts. I don't think it was. However, there's an interesting footnote to that. As I mentioned during this conference of 1898 here in New York to try to reform the rules of nominations and the focus on the direct primary, interestingly, some of the people who were supporting that move were progressives who were essentially anti-immigrant and who were concerned that immigrants who'd come to the United States in the 1890s, 1880s, and before were under the thrall of urban bosses who controlled their votes. And the direct primary, to the minds of these reformers, was seen as a way to break that lock of the bosses and because they thought that there was an undue or disproportionate influence or power that particularly immigrants were having in New York and in Chicago and in other big cities. Beyond that, and that was sort of an indirect demographic effect on the nominating rules because it did make a contribution to direct primaries. I guess the other thing I'd add is The migration of African Americans north during the First World War and after the first, and in the decades after the First World War, probably had as profound effect on the Democratic Party as anything that's happened, and eventually to some extent on the Republican, but mainly on the Democratic Party. Did it lead, because it led to immense debates and nomination fights and platform fights in the 40s and 50s and 60s over civil rights. Did that contribute to changes in the nominating rules? I'd have to think about that. I don't know the answer if it did or not. I kind of doubt it. All right?
Think about the 70s, though, yeah. And those, because my understanding, particularly around the move toward more superdelegates, actually was, you know, at least in part, explained by this this battle between the sort of traditionalists in the party and those who wanted greater minority participation. But I don't know if you think.
Well, I was going to say that the changes that were made initially in the 70s, I mean, look, obviously the 60s, there were so many different strands of criticism, political criticism and challenge, but fundamentally it was the anti-war left hostility to Hubert Humphrey,
right,
you know, who was Mr. Civil Rights in Congress as a senator. It was fundamentally the opposition to the war and the fact that a vice president of the man who was running the war managed to become president over the massive opposition of that part of the party that led to the reform commissions. Now remember, those commissions were trying, as I quoted, they were trying to open the process up. So that they were trying to open the process up. They weren't trying to produce a system that was this pure primary dominated system, although that's how their message ended up getting absorbed by the state parties. If we were to build in more of a role for party, elected party figures nationally and state, you know, these days, a little bit more of a form of peer review, it would reflect the demographics of who the elected officials are of both parties nationally and at the states, in the states. Now, you know, in the South today, in the Democratic Party, 35 to 40% of the elected legislators are African American in the Democratic Party in many of the southern states. And so when you're talking about putting in a greater role for elected state and national party figures, I think it would reflect the demographics of who's getting elected in each party, you know, under contemporary circumstances.
So we are out of time. I think one of the constant themes that has also run through what Fred and Rick have said in answer to your question, Donna, is that there are unintended consequences that play a huge role in the way the current system has evolved that are beside the great sweep of what the people in fighting for control of a party were trying to do. So on the word of unintended consequences guiding so much of what we do, thank you all very much for